Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Training for the New Alpinism, a manual for the climber as athlete, by Steve House and Scott Johnston. Foreword by Mark Twight. Narrated by Roger Wayne. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Training for the New Alpinism into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code READY, and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All recipes, graphs, tables, and figures, in addition to the appendix, glossary, and recommended reading referenced in this audiobook, can be found in the bonus material. Foreword: the edge of the map. I consider myself a charter member of the first generation of alpine climbers who trained intentionally using artificial means. For me, training was born a failure. When I failed, and it happened a lot, it was because ambition outstripped ability. I narrowed that lack of ability to physical issues often enough that I decided to do something about it. Chasing the first half of Brian Eno's motto, I pushed myself to the most extreme limits and reaped rewards. But it took years to fulfill the second half of that motto, which is retreat to a more useful position. My approach to training echoed how I climbed. The romance of climbing didn't interest me. I didn't seek harps and wings. I heard no opera up there. Instead, my mountains had teeth. The jagged edge we walked up there dragged itself across my throat and the throats of my friends and peers. I took the mountain's indifference to life as aggression and fought back. I armored myself against that indifference with training, with thinking, with attitude. I trained with friends who shared a similar approach. Our mantra was dark, but it motivated us. When we ran, we breathed in rhythm, no matter the speed. And that beat had words. They all died. We inhaled and exhaled the great alpine epics, like the tragedy that befell Walter Bonatti's party on the Fernet Pillar, to push ourselves to a place where we would never come up short physically. The consequences of falling short made training important. I realized early that controlling the things that I could control gave me greater freedom to address the things that I could not control. And the mountains offered those in spades. Unfortunately, I had no idea how to use the gym, and without someone to ask, I made many mistakes. I tried to mimic climbing in the weight room, but didn't comprehend how best to use this valuable tool, and wasted my time. The gym is useful as a means of overloading the organism in a way that can't, safely, be done in the real environment of alpinism. Later, my training sessions began by pre-fatiguing my body on a stairmaster or a treadmill, and then lifting, because that's how alpinism looked to me: approach and then climb. It took years to learn that doing the opposite sent hormonal signals more appropriate to physical development for alpine climbing. Then I read that some rock climbers use hypertrophy-style training to increase muscle mass and push limit strength higher. So we did that until I realized that mass had to be carried, whether it was being used or not. I had misused a specific training idea based on the mistaken premise that all climbing is the same. It isn't. Limit strength was never an issue in the mountains, but we wanted it to be, so that we could do that style of training. Eventually, I trained in a way that emphasized maximum recruitment of existing muscle. I had to carry my own engine, so it made sense to increase my power-to-weight ratio, to extract the maximum from existing resources. Then I reasoned, if the engine is still inadequate, I could increase its horsepower, as long as that doesn't affect fuel economy. The engine analogy produced an accurate description of our training objectives, which allowed us to think and plan in coherent terms. We decided that the ideal engine for alpinism could go forever, produce explosive force on demand, and keep delivering 50 to 60% of peak force without overheating. Tuning such diverse characteristics into an engine requires much of the mechanic, foremost of which is an understanding of the overall objectives. In Extreme Alpinism, Climbing Light, Fast, and High, I describe the goal of physical training for alpinism with the phrase, to make yourself as indestructible as possible. In short, resilience. For too long, I thought this concept was solely contingent on physical capacities, but eventually realized that these influence mental capacities. In fact, I think we revere the physical too much when it is the mind that imagines the goal, solves the problem, and achieves it, using the body as its engine. If physical training is a tool, it's a hammer. Often we swing it to the exclusion of all other tools because it feels like an easy fix. It features nearly immediate positive feedback as well as rapid progress, especially if you've never used one before. But increased physical capacity doesn't guarantee improvements to climbing. Often, strength blinds us to the benefits of technique or efficiency. We close our eyes and pull, but alpinism rarely rewards raw strength. Successful alpinists appear to be those who multiply physical force with the lever of creativity, confidence, and psychological resilience. Undertaken correctly, physical training is a useful means of psychological manipulation. Goals set, achieved, and surpassed in the gym, whether they are specifically transferable or not, stimulate psychological development we can express in the mountains. Constantly overcoming difficult training challenges and examining ourselves along the way improves self-assurance. That confidence frees imagination. It opens doors to new, more difficult projects and expands our problem-solving repertoire. To attempt the impossible demands a high-order explosion of confidence, sustained by the diesel-fueled physical capacity to back up that hubris. Neither capacity is powerful on its own, but a whole, well-trained mental-physical system is practically unstoppable. In this sense, we can bring our unrealistic ambitions within reach by figuratively changing the length and functionally increasing the strength of our arms. The really big routes I climbed didn't happen because I trained harder. Rather, they happened as a result of having trained better and climbed more. Frequency and consistency and accumulation allowed me to go harder, higher, and for longer. Increasing the intensity of the artificial training was never critical. Intensity played a minor role. It could not shortcut experience or efficiency. 20 years of consistent training squeezed wretched mental weakness out of me and built a vast foundation of accumulated fitness. The resulting deep physical tank and huge psychological reserve opened up terrain and timing that I could never have imagined without it. Training was one of the keys to my success as a climber, but not in the way I believed it would be when I hit the weight room that first time. These days, physical and mental training is my bread and butter. Strength training directly benefits the athlete who plays a sport in which the strongest always wins. That's not climbing. So we work indirectly. When we increase an athlete's work capacity, we improve that person's ability to recover. Then, climbing-specific training frequency can be increased, which means more climbing. A greater volume of quality sport-specific effort leads to improvement. This is training, but it is also lifestyle and managing it wholesale. To achieve this, we need a certain quantity and quality of knowledge. Unfortunately, much of what passes for fitness knowledge is actually marketing, or confined to the controlled conditions of a lab with no regard for biochemical or temperamental individuality. Steve and Scott have collected the vast data relevant to training and preparation for alpine climbing and are presenting it here in a practical, user-friendly manner. They back their thesis with their own remarkable experience and reinforce it with unique points of view contributed by climbers whose practice has had enormous influence on the evolution of the sport. On its own, the book is invaluable. Combined with the routes and adventures that it will surely inform, its impact on the evolution of the generations of future climbers will be great. I often say that greater fitness leads to more opportunity. This holds true for knowledge as well. When we acquire new skills, when we develop ourselves as human beings, we uncover new potential. The map gets bigger. we increase the scope of our world and the opportunities available in it. Training for the new alpinism might well take you right off the edge of the world as you know it. Mark Twight, Salt Lake City, June 2013. Introduction. The old becomes new again. It was a close, warm, breezeless summer night. Wan, dull and glaring, with a dripping fog low hung and thick that covered all the sky. But, undiscouraged, we began to climb the mountainside. William Wordsworth, The Prelude, 1799 to 1805. Physical exploration of the world was growing rapidly during the Romantic period, the time of Wordsworth. Early mountaineers were upper class and well educated, poets, photographers, geologists, painters, and natural historians. In 1895, the Englishman and alpinist Albert Mummery and four men undertook the first attempt to climb one of the Himalayas' giant peaks, the 26,660-foot, 8,126-meter high Nunga Purbit. Mummery and two of his men lost their lives in an avalanche during the attempt. Thus, climbing entered the 20th century with artistic grace tainted by extreme tragedy. This began the greatest period of growth in alpinism, particularly in the Alps. Technical standards rose rapidly. In 1906, 5.9 was first climbed in the Elbe Sandstone Mountains. Around the same time, Austrian Paul Preuss trained himself to do one-armed pull-ups and climbed and down-climbed alpine rock routes in the Dolomites to a modern grade of 5.8, solo and in hobnailed boots. By 1922, the top grade was 5.10D. Climbers of the time climbed many beautiful, difficult routes in the mountains. To modern climbers, they seem to have been driven by an innate curiosity to ascend, explore, and observe what would unfold in the process. The Great Wars twisted everything. The conquest of the world's 14 highest peaks after World War II became surrogate battlegrounds to reinforce superiority or symbolize rebirth, depending on whether your country had won or lost. Annapurna to the French, Everest to the British, Nanga Purbit to the Germans, K2 to the Italians. Ascent was transformed into conquest. Summits became symbols of nationalistic pride. The climbing of mountains was changed forever. This ended symbolically in 1980, when Reinhold Messner was asked why he did not carry his country's flag to the top of Everest, and he replied, "I did not go up for Italy, nor for South Tyrol. I went up for myself." Though his comment angered many at the time, the line was drawn. In the information age, all must be measured. For climbing, an emphasis on difficulty and speed emerged. Hardest, highest, fastest. In the age of social media, all must be shared. The resulting cocktail of cameras, danger, and testosterone are all too often tragic, rarely graceful. The new alpinism comes full circle, as small teams of fit, trained athletes emulate Mummery, aspire to Preuss, climb like the young Messner. Because those pioneers knew that alpinism, indeed all mindful pursuits, is at its most simple level the sum of your daily choices and daily practices. Progress is entirely personal. The spirit of climbing does not lie in outcomes, lists, times, your conquests. You do keep those. You will always know which mountains you have climbed, which you have not. What you can climb is a manifestation of the current, temporary state of your whole self. You can't fake a sub-4-minute mile just as you can't pretend to do an asana. Ascent, too, is an expression of many skills developed, refined, mastered. Training is the most important vehicle for preparation. Constant practice begets examination and refinement of technique as well as fitness. It is not our natural tendency to value struggle over success, a worldview that climbing sternly enforces. Embracing struggle for its own sake is an important step on your path. Incremental vacillations in yourself, your physical and mental selves, are exquisitely revealed in practicing ascent. There is no end to your progress or your process. For the two of us, the pursuit of climbing mountains has been among the most powerful personal experiences we have known. Nothing else has come close to the blunt power of climbing to inform us about ourselves. We don't presume to tell anyone what the new alpinism will actually become. No one can know this. But we do think that we have earned the perspective to point in the right general direction. Structured, progressive training will be a big component, perhaps define the future of alpine climbing. But not because it will help you climb harder, faster, though it will. Training prepares your body and, most important, your mind for ascent through consistent, hard, disciplined practice. Go simply. Train smart. Climb well. Chapter 1. Training for the New Alpinism. What advantages do we hope to gain from climbing mountains? Naturally, there is the pleasure we get from the climbing process itself and from our victories. But as well as the delights of exercise in a mountain environment, there is also the process, coming every time as a surprise, of self-discovery, deepening a little further with every climb. Who we are, how far we can go, what is our potential, where are the limits of our technique, our strength, our skill, our mountaineering sense. Discoveries whose acceptance means that, if necessary, we may turn back and return another time, several times if need be. Tomorrow is a new day. Gaston Rebuffat, from the Mont Blanc Massif, The 100 Finest Routes. Most of what climbers describe as training today happens as a substitute for climbing. You can't climb because you're far from the mountains, so you train. Common examples include the lunchtime run or an after-work visit to the climbing gym. As soon as alpinists have time and access to mountains, they stop training because they can go climbing instead. This is the wrong approach if you want to progress your climbing, and has contributed to the dead-end standards of alpine climbing. Standards in rock climbing have skyrocketed since 1978, from 5.13 to 5.15. It's no coincidence that during the same period, we've seen the emergence of climbing gyms and youth competitions. Today, standards in alpinism languish. Steve attempted an unclimbed line on the west face of Makalu 3 times between 2008 and 2011, and was unable to match the high point established by Voytek Kurtyka and Alex McIntyre in 1982. New routes, established in alpine style on 8,000-meter peaks with sustained technical difficulties, are so rare that, by our accounting, this has been accomplished only 5 times in history. 1984 by Neil Boagis and Enric Lucas on Annapurna, 1991 by Marco Preselge and André Stremfelge on Kanchenjunga South, 2005 by Vince Anderson and Steve House on Nanga Parbat, 2009 by Boris Tedeschko and Denis Arubko on Choi Oyu, and 2013 by Ueli Steck on Annapurna. Structured coaching in competitive sports and recently in sport climbing and bouldering helps athletes learn how to train. This is not a part of alpine climbing's culture. Alpinists climb. We have been brought up to believe that to get stronger we must simply climb a lot, and with climbing, fitness will follow. If you aspire to climb difficult routes on Patagonian spires and you have only been rock climbing for a short time, then you are best advised to spend a majority of your time climbing granite cracks and do so as much as possible. No book can teach you how to lead a run-out pitch. No story can show you how to bivouac. You can read 1,000 accounts of leading a steep, difficult hand crack far above the Patagonian ice cap, but that will bring you no closer to actually doing it. The fact is that you will gain the strength and endurance to climb a hard pitch much, much more quickly with a training regime plus climbing than by climbing alone. After learning the physiology explained in the early chapters of this book, You will also understand that the majority of your climbing is best done below your top limit. This is for endurance, as well as technique and psychological progress. This knowledge will help you gain the strength and endurance, and from that strength and endurance, the disciplined mind and the correct technique will flow more easily. One of the fundamental concepts of training for any sport is that event, climbing, specific training must come on top of a very well-established base of conditioning. We acknowledge that climbing, and particularly alpine climbing, is a very highly skill-dependent sport requiring a broad range of knowledge, experience, and ability. It is exactly this need for climbing skill that tends to push alpinists and all climbers to just climb for training. Consider that, in the sport of running, the explosive power of a 100-meter sprinter and the dogged endurance of the ultramarathoner are both running, yet the two are vastly different events. The surprise to many is that training for both of these events starts with the same general strength and conditioning to enhance basic physical qualities. As the 100-meter runner and the ultramarathoner progress through their training plan and through their careers, each will benefit from more and more specific training. This means that each will spend more and more time running distances and paces closer and closer to what they hope to achieve during their race. They know that the higher their level of basic fitness at the time they commence their event-specific training, the higher their performance will peak in their ultimate event. For conventional endurance sports, such as running, the event-specific training makes up a smaller percentage of the total volume of training than you might imagine, both on an annual basis as well as during a lifetime. Depending on the development stage and the nature of the goals, specific training, meaning running a distance and pace approaching race distance and pace, can range from less than 10% of total training volume for young people and beginners up to a maximum of about 30% for world-class athletes. Athletes commonly lose sight of the distinction between supportive basic training and the event-specific training and begin to overemphasize more event-specific training. The event-specific training and actual performances are the sexy stuff that makes impressive YouTube videos and exciting headlines that create the urban myths surrounding champions. Is there an alpinist who has not been inspired by the video of Ueli Steck soloing the 1938 route on the north face of the Eiger in 2 hours and 48 minutes? One would have to be soulless not to feel motivated while watching the video of David Radisha crushing his competition in the 800-meter Olympic final in the 2012 London Olympics as he set yet another world record. What you do not see as you watch these masters perform at the peak fitness of their lives are the countless hours of basic, non-event-specific, supportive training that went into their record-breaking. To shed more light on how conventional sport can inform training for climbing, we'll use some analogies. Take the sport of cross-country ski racing, which Scott has an extensive background in as both an athlete and a coach at the World Cup level. These events demand that the athletes be able to sustain power levels between 95% up to 120% of their VO2 max for durations of up to several minutes at a time on gently rolling terrain to long, steep uphills. Then, they need to recover quickly during the fast and often technically demanding downhill sections so that they can repeat the maximal efforts again many times over during a race lasting up to or a little over 2 hours. Technique is critical to success due to the large contribution economy of movement plays in determining speed. For the best skiers in this sport, approximately 80% of training volume is made up of non-event-specific training in such a way that the event, a ski race in this case, is broken down into its component parts and the training is focused on improving the athlete's abilities specific to those components. We can and will teach you how to apply this with climbing. In cross-country ski racing, these components can be represented by strength and power training, various intensities and modes of aerobic base conditioning, technique drills, etc. Only 20% of their overall yearly volume is spent doing training that specifically models the demands of an actual race. For the climber training for the Disappointment Cleaver route on Mountaineer, The training will be fairly simple, since the principal quality required for that event is aerobic endurance, and technique is not a major factor. The non-climbing specific work will include strength training, but will mainly consist of hiking and running in the mountains. As the training progresses, it will include climbs of non-technical peaks with snow or glaciers. It is easy to see how the non-specific training of hiking up and down hills lends support to the more demanding mountaineer climb. This translation to climbing becomes more complicated when the event becomes a technical alpine route, possibly at altitude. Start to think like a coach, and it should quickly become apparent that the basic supportive training will encompass all of the rainier climbers' training, with the addition of technically demanding routes of various lengths and difficulties that challenge several of the physical and mental qualities needed to succeed at the main goal. To extend the analogy, you wouldn't train on climbs that encompass all aspects of your goal, but rather component parts. It can happen that some of these non-specific training climbs may be admirable accomplishments in their own right. Just as a conventional athlete racks up an impressive resume of jaw-droppingly difficult workouts and race wins on his way to setting a world record or winning an Olympic gold medal. One challenge for the alpinist with lofty goals is coming up with event-specific training. In other words, finding routes that combine components of the traits needed on the goal route. Alpinism has traditionally given lip service to this notion without fully understanding the context within which it fits. Climbers in North America have progressed from their home range to the Canadian Rockies to the Alps, with perhaps a stint in the Alaska Range thrown in before heading to the Himalaya. Gaston Rebuffat, in fact, gave a step-by-step guide to this progressive approach in 1973, when he published The Mont Blanc Massif, The 100 Finest Routes, which leads aspiring alpinists one step at a time through a progression of the skill acquisition aspect of becoming an alpinist. But the message was not fully conveyed in terms of how this progression fits into the big picture of physically and mentally training for alpinism. Steve has used the approach we advocate in this book by spending a prodigious amount of time on basic, supportive, non-event-specific training. He has then successfully built upon that with progressively more event-specific training on more and more demanding alpine routes. At the elite level, it will be necessary to travel far and wide and plan long and hard to find appropriate event-specific training climbs. Let's use another running analogy to make a point. Do you think Usain Bolt trains for setting the world record in the 100 and 200 meter track events by going to the track every day and running to break his old record? If you do, then you are vastly mistaken. He trains the many components that, when combined, allow him to be the fastest human ever. Only a tiny fraction of his time is spent actually running the 100 or 200 meters at race intensity. Look at one of the most quantifiable areas of climbing, sport climbing. Does it make sense that top-level sport climbers should spend the bulk of their time trying to climb right at their limit, working a project, with only a tiny fraction of their training volume spent climbing other, easier routes? Why don't top sport climbers like Chris Sharma climb new 5.15s every week? If he can do it once, he can do it weekly, right? Wrong. This would be akin to Bolt running 100s at race pace several days a week in hopes of improving the physical qualities that allow him to break his record again. Top coaches and athletes in conventional sports abandoned this approach to training long ago. The information in this book is strongly rooted in the science of human physiology, which draws upon decades of research and practice. We often look to other sports to learn what makes their best athletes. The best athletes, be they a runner, cyclist, skier, or football player, are not born with tree trunk legs or greyhound lungs. Typically, they train with a coach, probably from a very early age. Their bodies adapt to every workout, every meal, every rest, to slowly, additively, become incredible athletes. Who has followed the same path in alpine climbing? No one. Yet. Those who execute on this path will be the ones to change alpine climbing forever. Training for alpinism is different in some ways than training for other sports. The duration is longer, sometimes more than a week. The intensity is intermittent, Cruxes come and cruxes go. The event, the climb, can often not be put on your calendar months in advance. When the weather clears, you climb. Failure can be fatal. Alpinism carries significant mortal risk. Buhl, Messner, Bonatti, Habeler, Lauriton, Scott, McIntyre, Kammerlander, Kukuchka, and Kurtyka. These are the names of those who raised the bar of alpinism in the 20th century. They mostly used climbing as their training for climbing, with Buhl, Messner, and Habeler being notable exceptions for their times. For those with talent equal to these legends, that will be enough. Steve counts himself among those with no special athletic talent. In alpinism, the most talented are unlikely to be those who will change how we climb. Talent can make you lazy. Innovation will be left to the hardest workers, training intelligently. In the spring of 2004, Steve had completed his first single year of training under Scott's tutelage. In April, after a strenuous 6-day climb of the north face of North Twin with Mark Preselge, he navigated in a whiteout across the Columbia ice field for 14 hours while breaking trail through new snow. Steve was tired, but he retained the physical and mental reserves to put them in exactly the right spot after a 20-mile crossing by map, compass, and GPS. 3 months later, in Pakistan, he soloed a new route on K7 in 44 hours round trip from base camp. This was the first time in the history of alpine climbing that someone had climbed such a difficult route on such a high mountain alone and survived. 1 year later, Vince Anderson and Steve climbed what is regarded as the most difficult route established on an 8,000-meter peak, climbing alpine style. The approach we've taken and shared in this book works. And what of those climbers who have been alpinists all their lives without any need for records or firsts? What of Gaston Rebuffat's admonition for self-discovery, deepening a little further with every climb? Who we are, how far we can go, what is our potential? Where are the limits of our technique, our skill, our strength, our mountaineering sense? That is here as well. Training becomes an important path to your self-discovery, a part of your climbing. First Steps, Missteps by Steve House. I take a deep gasp of air and swing a tool at the lip of the ice wall. I glance up at Marco Preselge, standing above me, waiting. I gasp and pull up. My legs feel like jelly. My shoulders burn for oxygen. I cock my tool back to make another swing. Marco turns and climbs off, rhythmically ascending the wind-scoured ice toward 22,967 feet, 7,000 meters, on Nupts's south face. I allow a half-rest, expel my breath hard as I swing, pull, and start after him, cueing my kicks to the staccato rhythm of his ascent. In 2002, after a 60-hour ascent of Denali's Slovak Direct and a 25-hour climb of Mount Foraker's Infinite Spur under my belt, I thought I was ready to trade up to the big leagues, climbing in the Himalaya. Marco Preselge, whom I'd met in Alaska, was the perfect partner, a veteran of over a dozen Himalayan expeditions with many alpine-style ascents to his credit. That spring, high on Nupsi, the wind seemed to pull the breath out of me. Despite my success in Alaska, I was not fit enough to climb these great walls. Back home, I attended the Nordic Ski Club workouts with Laura McCabe, a 2-time Olympian. Nordic skiing is known as one of the hardest sports with some of the fittest athletes, and there I met my first coach, a Canadian Nordic skier who had recently finished her MS in exercise physiology. With the help of Patagonia, Inc., I hired my first coach, trading clothing for a training program with the goal of a new route in alpine style on 25,659-foot, 7,821-meter-high Masherbrum. By the time the snow flew, I would wake in the dark to strap on Nordic skis and skate to the local trails by headlamp before reporting to work at 7 a.m. at North Cascades Heliskiing, where I'd spent 4 of every 7 days fulfilling people's jet-fueled quest for powder. I bought a heart rate monitor that I used during each training session and tracked every minute spent in Zone 2, a low heart rate, steadily collecting endurance hour by hour. In June 2003, at Masher Brum Base Camp, Marco and I started up a little-known 21,000-foot, 6,401-meter peak to acclimate. Marco accelerated away from me like I was standing still. I had felt good that morning, so I decided that Marco must have played a trick on me by putting a rock in my pack. He's funny like that. I stopped in the middle of the couloir and emptied every single item out of my pack. No rock. Home once again, without success on Masher Brum, I stopped by to visit my friend Scott Johnston, and we began talking about Masher Brum, which led back to my training that winter.
"You were way overtrained," Scott told me. "All due respect to your coach, but I don't think she understands alpinism. She trained you like a skier, and you worked like a mountaineer."
I admitted I had not recorded my hours of heliski guiding as training time. Scott scoffed in disbelief.
"That was stupid."
"I was skiing downhill, Scott, with a helicopter to haul us up to the top of each run. You hardly count that as training." What followed was a long and careful explanation from Scott of some basic training principles, the same ideas that form the foundation of this book, the same principles all top-level coaches and athletes subscribe to. Since that day in 2003, Scott taught and guided me to most of what I know about training. This information is based on many decades of research done by a committed scientific community that studies human performance, and by Scott's own years of competing at national and World Cup levels in both swimming and Nordic skiing. Add to that Scott's many climbing expeditions to Alaska, Canada, and the Himalaya, and he has acquired a set of knowledge and experiences that is, to my mind, unique in the climbing world. Don't epic. Keep it under control. By Ueli Steck. I am a control freak. Even in daily life, I need a very strong structure. On the mountain, I need to have the feeling that I have everything under control. I think this attitude keeps me alive. Fortunately, I'm a coward. Otherwise, my ambition would have ruined me already. I need a clear goal. I'm not the type of person who climbs a bit and then by chance goes for a run. I always need a goal, and that goal is the foundation for an efficient workout. There is a difference whether you want to climb an 8,000-meter peak, climb 5.13 free solo, or free climb El Cap. You have to accept that you cannot be your best all the time at every climbing discipline. If I want to free climb a route on El Cap, I don't run a marathon. I spend my time climbing because running takes the time and energy that I could spend on training for rock climbing. Also, cardiovascular training like running needs to be adapted to my specific goal. I need a different kind of endurance to climb the north face of Eiger as fast as possible than I need for a Himalayan ascent. These details make the crucial difference. Exactly here it starts to get interesting. I have already lived my own experiences. I know exactly what it takes to get to this level of fitness. Training needs to vary periodically. The body cannot run all year at the highest level. That's a big problem for many climbers. They feel pressure to always be their best. Trying to peak all the time creates a plateau, and no more performance improvements will be possible until you break the cycle. With appropriate training, you will reach peak periods that are much higher than this plateau. You only have to arrange that you peak at the right moment, and this requires a plan. I always train according to a plan. For me, climbing is a continuous development. I always wanted to set a climbing speed record on the Eiger North Face. I've done it by optimizing my training for that route. The next step was to on-site speed climb an unknown route, and on the north faces of the Grand Jorasse and the Matterhorn, I realized that goal. With this knowledge, I've opened up new possibilities for myself. I know I can climb a wall of 1,000 meters, 3,281 feet, in 2 hours and 30 minutes without knowing the route. For the Himalaya, this opens new dimensions. I had 1.5 days of nice weather on Shishapangma, and the south wall is 2,000 meters, 6,561 feet high. Climbing a wall like this in a weather window of 1.5 days is what I was looking for. The route I was climbing was quite challenging, with steep, rocky passages. 10.5 hours later, I stood on the summit. A weather report for 2 days is always very precise. That means, overall, I have a big safety reserve on routes like this, and this security comes from my physical fitness. I can calculate exactly, so I don't have any dangerous adventures, no epics. The most important thing is that you come back, with or without summiting. You have to be honest with yourself that in the end, no one really cares. You do it for yourself. Everyone must decide for him or herself how much risk he or she wants to take. Risk is not measurable and is always dependent on the individual. You need to know that it is impossible to indefinitely push your limits. Higher, faster, better. Eventually, you will reach a peak, and then it goes back down. I believe it's important that you don't lose your passion, and that you enjoy the outdoors and challenging yourself, no matter what your level is.
Swiss alpinist Ueli Steck's name is synonymous with training for alpinism. He is perhaps most famous for climbing the north face of the Eiger in 2 hours and 48 minutes.
Section 1. The Methodology and Physiology of Endurance Training. Chapter 2. The Methodology of Endurance Training. Alpinism is the art of climbing mountains by confronting the greatest dangers with the greatest prudence. Art is used here to mean the accomplishment of knowledge in action. You cannot stay on the summit forever. You have to come down again. So what's the point? Only this. What is above knows what is below. What is below does not know what is above. While climbing, take note of all the difficulties along your path. During the descent, you will no longer see them, but you will know that they are there if you have observed carefully. There is an art to finding your way in the lower regions by the memory of what you have seen when you were higher up. When you can no longer see, you can at least still know. René Dummel, from Mount Analog. The Alpinist as Athlete. Many would argue that alpinism is art, not sport. Alpinism places unique demands on its practitioners. In no organized sport do the participants have to endure days of struggle just to get to the starting line of their event. The option to drop out of a race that is going badly does not exist for a climber halfway up a big route, and may entail more risk than pushing on. A team of volunteers will not be waiting with warm blankets and hot food at the next bivvy ledge. When you reach the summit, having overcome the challenges that inspired you for months or years, you are not at the finish line. The race is not over. You can't relax and let your guard down like a normal athlete. The descent is often as much or more of a challenge as the climb. We can respect the gulf that separates alpinism from a running race and still appreciate that the physiology that accounts for endurance is the same if you are running for a foot race in the city park or front-pointing up the second ice field on the north face of the Eiger. We climbers have much to learn from the training done in conventional sports. Structured training for climbing is a relatively recent phenomenon. So far, most of the literature and practice has been focused specifically on rock climbing. A half century of trial and error has produced some excellent resources for those looking to apply modern strength training theory to rock climbing.
Alpine climbing, on the other hand, is the last bastion of training Luddites.
Historically, many of the great names in alpine climbing seem to have just gone climbing as training. In fact, the model alpinist has often portrayed himself in literature as a half-crazed nonconformist, living life on the edge every moment he's sober enough to climb. It is true that amazing feats of skill and daring have been accomplished using this rather random approach. For some climbers, that life-on-the-edge approach may be the only way they can accomplish these feats. But there are far better methods to prepare for the challenges of alpine climbing. Even though Vince Lombardi used this quote for football, it is perhaps even more poignant for alpinism. Fatigue makes cowards of us all. In the mountains, fatigue is the biggest controllable limitation that will come between you and success. You will never exploit your full technical capacity if your fitness remains a weak link. Conventional sports have undergone an evolution in training methods during the last 50 years. Curiosity and the inherent improvement brought about by competition have driven this evolution to a state of high refinement, such that today's athletes have a very specialized approach to training at the elite levels. On big routes and big mountains, speed equals safety. Traveling fast over complex technical terrain requires a high level of technical ability and the endurance to support it. These two quite divergent capabilities need to be developed over years of practice. Omitting either limits your potential. Getting Results by Steve House. In the autumn of 2003, upon returning from Mashabrum, I started into my new training program with Scott. At the time, I was fresh off my first real success in the Himalaya, a solo new route on an unclimbed 19,685-foot, 6,000-meter peak in the Karakoram. In the next 24 months, between September 2003 and September 2005, I would succeed on a large number of significant alpine routes. The Talkeetna Standard, a new route on Alaska's Eyetooth. The second descent of the Roberts-Rowell Ward route on the east face of Mount Dickey. The Howes-Presilge variation to the Low Jones route on the north face of North Twin. A new route established alone on K7 in a 41-hour round-trip push. An attempt to 24,278 feet, 7,400 meters, on Nanga Purbit's Rupel face with Bruce Miller. Red pointing various rock climbs up to 5.12D. On-site three alpine rock routes to 5.12B at 17,000 feet, 5,180 meters, on Peru's La Esfinge. A new route with Marco Presilge on the west face of Cayche. The first free ascent of the French route on Telaraju with Marco Presilge. The Anderson House route on the Rupel face of Nanga Purbit. To me, it is clear I was able to do those climbs because of the training. I was mentally focused and fully committed to alpine climbing, and that commitment played a big part in the success. But at the end of the day, I did those climbs because I was fit. I had a big base from a lifetime of athletics, over 15 years of climbing and 12 years of guiding on top of a hyperactive youth, and the training refined that fitness. This is the identical approach that Scott and I share in this book, building a base and then refining that fitness for the objective at hand. Without that training, most of these routes would not have been realized. Transitions by Zoe Hart. I grew up in suburban New Jersey playing traditional sports. It was easy to stay fit as part of a team and with someone else to manage my training program. Halfway through my junior year of college, soon after I found climbing, I gave up my spot on the Division I Big East Championship softball team for climbing dreams. The next several years, I was acutely aware of the lack of discipline in my practice of climbing, and I missed the support of my teammates. I wondered how to train, how to stay fit. Everyone did something different, but the best answer always seemed to be just to climb. And so I climbed. But in between climbing trips, I lost both my fitness and motivation. When I finished university, I was able to climb full-time, and fitness came easily. Climbing, learning, pushing grades. Eventually, I found work as a mountain guide and established more balance in my life, with some downtime and a home base. I also arrived at a plateau in my training. With horror, I watched my fitness ebb.
A friend pointed out that it would be a shame to not see how far I could go in climbing if I were to train and live with discipline. It was then that I started to think about food as fuel, to think about what muscle groups climbing taxes and how to strengthen them. I found my way past that plateau, thanks to the help of a friend and personal trainer who helped me to develop a program. Finding a structure for my habitually haphazard training regime helped me to work through my weaknesses. Throughout the fall, I balanced sessions in the gym with long trail runs and climbing days mixed with periods of rest. I found myself climbing strong and confident by the time the winter mixed climbing season came around. That winter, I led run-out, heady mixed routes in Scotland and hard mixed climbs on the granite of the Northeast. I placed second in the Ouray mixed climbing competition and shared leads on cryptophobia, a long, hard mixed line in Alberta, Canada. With day-to-day discipline and hard work, I found that I could achieve goals I had previously seen as out of reach. Training gave me confidence in my body, which equaled confidence in my mind.
Zoe Hart lives in France, where she works as an IFMGA certified mountain guide and professional alpinist. Her current transition is learning the balance of motherhood. The two types of training.
There are really only two types of training for any sport. 1. The general conditioning that readies you for event-specific training. This conditioning consists of a mixture of strength and endurance training and may not be climbing-specific. 2. That training that prepares you in a specific way for the event itself. This training consists primarily of climbing or workouts that model directly the specific demands of climbing. It is important to understand that the role of non-specific training is not intended to be of immediate benefit to your climbing, unless, of course, you have low fitness. Its purpose is to generate a base of support to do the specific workouts and the training for climbing. Putting some numbers to it. How much you prepare depends completely on your training background and goals. Motivation, along with realistic time and energy allotments, is often the biggest limitation to the time you can allot for training. You can't coach desire, and no matter how fancy your training plan or how high your stated goals are, it comes down to getting out the door and doing the work day after day. World-class endurance athletes spend a prodigious amount of time training for their races. At the highest levels, it is truly a full-time job, allowing for only enough time and energy to rest and refuel between workouts. Here are some examples to put things in perspective. Running, being the least efficient and most stressful on the body, generally consumes the least number of dedicated hours for top athletes. In a week of training, around 16 hours will be spent running. This translates to about 120 miles of running, plus a couple of strength training sessions. Of all types of endurance athletes, cyclists can tolerate the most training. They need it, due to the non-weight-bearing seated posture and the efficiency of the bike. Many pros ride their bikes between 25 to 30 hours per week. Top swimmers can train in the 20-hour-per-week range. World Cup cross-country skiers can surpass 20 to 25 hours, with yearly volumes of 800 to 1,000 hours being normal for the top men. Elite-level women in these sports generally train in the range of about 10% less than the best men. This is usually due to women competing at shorter distances than the men. However, in the marathon, Ironman triathlon, and ultramarathon running events, the top women train at the same levels as the men. There is no reason they cannot do as much as their male counterparts. This will be the same for women alpinists. Between 2003 and 2009, Steve trained in the range of 820 to 942 hours per year, which put his volume on a par with other world-class endurance athletes. When you read of his ascents, such as the Rupel face climb, you are seeing what Dr. K. Anders Ericsson, the psychologist and world expert on excellence, calls the iceberg illusion, the end product of a preparation process measured in years. He had no special talents but had created a structure in his life where he could devote himself fully to climbing and train with Scott as his coach. When you watch or read about the accomplishments of any great climber, what you don't see is the thousands of hours of climbing and other training that have literally altered their anatomical and neurological structures so that they can accomplish what is otherwise impossible. The point we hope to make with these figures is not to intimidate you or to suggest that you must train at this level to succeed. What we want to make clear is that your results will be proportional to the time you spend in preparation. Keep these figures in mind as a yardstick when considering what is humanly possible for athletes of any discipline that have spent years steadily increasing training loads. 3 45-minute Stairmaster workouts a week will not allow you to reach your ultimate potential. But this may be a perfectly reasonable starting place for you given your personal constraints. The important thing is to progress, adapt, and in the process, learn some valuable lessons. A brief discussion of physiology basics. While athletes do not need to be exercise physiologists, understanding the basics of how and why your body responds to training will be necessary for you to develop your own training plan. Very few of us have the luxury of a private coach. Without a coach, you need to have some means of guiding your own training. This guidance is best found in a sound application of current exercise science. These are principles that governed our training choices for Steve, and we have learned a lot from their experience. What we propose to do in these first chapters is to give you a simplified understanding of an extremely complex physical system. With this basic knowledge, we'll lay out methods to apply this theory to your own training. Climbing movements are the result of muscular contraction. Muscles require energy to contract. That energy comes from a chemical process called metabolism. We'll go into a bit more depth in Chapter 3, but for now, you can envision metabolism as a pathway of energy production. One of these pathways is aerobic, meaning that it depends on oxygen for the chemical reactions it uses to produce this energy for movement. The other pathway is anaerobic, meaning that the energy for movement can be produced in the absence of oxygen. Ever since our single-cell predecessors crawled out of the primordial muck into an oxygen-rich atmosphere, much of life on Earth has developed an aerobic metabolism. Humans are very much aerobic organisms and can live only a few minutes without oxygen. However, like our simpler, very distant cousins, yeast and bacteria, we humans have also retained the capacity for anaerobic metabolism as well. Ironically, considering our reliance on oxygen for energy, we actually supply our maximum power output anaerobically, albeit for only a very short time. Using all of their anaerobic capacity, a few champion sprint track cyclists have been known to develop maximum power outputs in excess of 1,800 watts for a few seconds. But before you get too impressed, keep in mind that this is only a bit more than the power of a cheap blow dryer that you can hold in one hand. In reality, we humans are pretty puny when it comes to absolute strength and power. On the other hand, our aerobic metabolism allows us to produce moderate power for very long periods. We call this attribute aerobic endurance, and we will explore this quality in some depth throughout this book. A fit human can run down most other animals in a contest of endurance. A succinct definition of endurance is the ability to resist fatigue in both a muscular and cardiovascular sense. While this may sound like a vague definition, how much fatigue? For how long must one resist that fatigue? In fact, it pertains directly to any activity you choose. Alpine climbing, where the efforts need to be sustained for a minimum of several hours, and often for days on end, demands one type of endurance.
A sport climber red-pointing at his limit, where the climber needs to sustain near-maximal efforts for a few minutes, needs another type of endurance.
Thus, the qualities that make up endurance and the training of those qualities varies depending on the application. This concept will take up the vast majority of our discussion in these early chapters. The adaptation to a training stimulus. While at the chemical level of metabolism, the efficiency of the different energy pathways is relatively fixed. With proper training, you can alter the type of reactions, lipolysis, the metabolism of fats, or glycolysis, the metabolism of sugars, that are occurring. Whichever metabolic process your training promotes, through that training, you prioritize that energy pathway and greatly influence the performance outcomes, Certain enzymes that aid metabolism are produced because they are more practical when the body is not doing any athletic activity. So, a sedentary person will possess a higher concentration of these enzymes in his muscle tissues. In other words, a lazy slug will have lazy slug enzymes that work very well for a lazy slug, but not well for an athlete. The enzymes that help an athlete function more efficiently must be produced, and they get produced only in response to the body realizing, through repeated bouts of activity, that they are needed. These enzymes will not work well for the lazy slug. If this slug somehow had these athletic enzymes, they would never get used, and the body would get rid of them since they are just taking up space. The body only builds, keeps, and maintains what is used and needed, which is why your training must be consistent. In order to respond to or improve from our training efforts, both the body's functional and structural systems must be stimulated to do so. Training purposefully stresses those systems just enough so that the body thinks that the systems are at risk of failing their purpose, or are too close to injury for comfort. Your training must be stressful enough to stimulate change, but not so stressful as to damage your body. Obviously, this is a fine distinction. Allow sufficient time for your body to absorb the training load and avoid injury. Understanding the training response cycle is critical to effective and safe training. The training effect. Training is not the work that you do. It is the value and the cost of your body's response to that work. Legendary coach Renato Canova. Canova's runners have garnered more world records, world championships, and Olympic medals than those of any other running coach. The human body has an amazing capacity to adapt to physical stress, but it does this best if that stress is applied in a constructive, consistent, and progressive manner. To see progress in your fitness, you need to temporarily put some systems of the body into a crisis state and allow the body to restore its homeostasis through its natural regenerative processes. This stress/recovery process results in what is termed a training effect. If properly coordinated, these adaptive mechanisms result in a process known as supercompensation, whereby your body overcompensates and ends up at a higher fitness level than before the stress of training was applied. Only the body systems that experience the stress of training adapt to handle future stress better. If there is a new training stimulus applied while your body is still in a supercompensated state, the resultant new level of adaptation will be higher than the previous one. In principle, this progression of load and adaptation is the goal of all well-structured training. This consistent and progressive nature is what sets training apart from simply exercising for health, and is one of the trickiest aspects to get right. The various changes that your body undergoes due to this training effect occur at different rates, and the restorative periods can vary from a few hours to several days, depending on which body systems experience stress. The guiding principles: continuity, gradualness, and modulation. These three words embody the principles of all successful training programs. A solid understanding of them will help you build your program from general to more specific conditioning. As mentioned earlier, correct training places one or more of your body's systems into a crisis state. These stresses impact the body's structural and functional systems. By structural, we mean the actual protein structures of your body, muscle, capillaries, mitochondria, etc. By functional, we mean the metabolic, enzymatic, hormonal, and other physiological functions that exist within the structures. The myriad numbers of processes that occur to both these systems take place at varying rates. Some of these adaptations occur on the order of hours. Others occur over the course of days, weeks, or even years. A failure to adapt, known as stagnation, can occur, and if unaddressed, can lead to overtraining, which results in a diminishing level of fitness. It takes time for the body to adjust to the training load you impose. A reapplication of another similar training stress will not give you the benefits you seek if your body's structural and functional systems have not sufficiently adapted to your current training load. Continuity. Continuity in training refers to maintaining a regular schedule of training with minimal interruption. You have to be motivated and disciplined to fulfill the requirements of the plan you lay out. Obviously, there needs to be some flexibility to account for the unexpected. Lapses in training do happen. They can be managed, but they cannot be overlooked. If you miss a week of training due to work, travel, or sickness, you can't pretend that you actually did all that training and progressed to the next part of the plan. Your body will not be adapted to the next step, and you'll be likely to have setbacks. How you manage this discontinuity depends on its length and the reason for it. Occasional breaks of a couple of days are not much of a problem as long as they do not diminish the training load by more than roughly 5% in a month. But frequent or prolonged breaks from training that amount to more than 10% of the monthly volume do create a need to adjust your subsequent training. Gradualness. Gradualness is an acknowledgement of the body's limited capability to adapt to the training stimulus. As inspirational as the movies may have been, Sylvester Stallone violated this basic principle repeatedly in the Rocky series. Hollywood allows that sort of fantasy. Real life does not. Occupational bursts or lapses of enthusiasm and motivation that result in big jumps in training load are a common approach to training by beginners and dabblers. The results from this sporadic exercise, we can't call it training, will never lead to good results. Your body's numerous systems require time to adapt to the various stresses you apply with a training load. Gradualness is a virtue that cannot be overemphasized. A gradual progression of the training load means different things for different athletes. Beginners and those with a low annual volume of training can progress faster than those with many years of training who are closer to their ultimate potential fitness. As a general rule, beginners can increase training volume by as much as 25% per year and up to 50% during a 3-week training cycle. Advanced athletes will be unable to make such jumps because they are already operating much closer to their body's capacity. For them, a 10% jump in yearly volume should be considered a maximum. Elite-level athletes often make no change in overall annual training volume, instead seeking gains by juggling the amount of higher intensity and specific training. Modulation. Modulation is the undulating level of training stimulus that allows your body a chance to recover its homeostasis, biological equilibrium in living organisms, after that crisis period. But it will also allow you to overload those intended systems and then put them into the next and higher crisis state with the new, higher training load. Depending on the systems you intend to stress, this modulation can follow a cycle measured in hours up to one measured in days. It can take 3 weeks for some significant changes to happen in the structural and functional systems. With care, an athlete can modulate his training to allow several systems to adapt at the same time. Through empirical processes, coaches have come to realize that adaptation occurs in roughly 3 to 6 week cycles. During the first 3 weeks, your body rapidly adapts. During the next 3 weeks, if the training load is held constant, it begins to yield diminishing results as your body structurally and functionally adapts to that training stimulus. During these second 3 weeks, many of the adaptations begin to consolidate, creating a base upon which to build the next step upward on the fitness ladder. Once your body is adapted to the stress of the current training load, what used to be a crisis state will no longer be enough to cause your body to keep adapting. Some creative changes to the training load need to be implemented for the next 3-week cycle, or progress will stop as you become adapted to this new level of crisis. These changes vary according to the qualities that the athlete hopes to develop. For a quality such as endurance, these adjustments are simple and involve mostly an increase in the volume of training, along with the concurrent increase in speed at the individual's aerobic threshold pace. For the simultaneous training of different qualities such as speed and endurance or power and endurance, even more elaborate training systems need to be implemented, which is beyond the scope of this book and must be administered with care and finesse, usually by a coach. Specificity. Only the systems that are stressed are going to see the training effect. That being said, Beginner endurance athletes and those with long lapses in their training history can make good gains in fitness initially by doing any prolonged endurance activity. As your fitness improves, your gains in climbing-specific fitness will become more elusive unless you shift to activities directly related to your intended activity. For example, at this stage in his career, Steve won't see much benefit to his climbing speed from swimming laps or paddling a canoe for hours on a lake. For him, these can be very beneficial recovery workouts. However, a person with very limited endurance training background will see an improvement in overall fitness from these general exercises, which will translate into improved climbing performance. This principle is known as the specificity of training. By specificity, we mean that the most effective training will be specific to the movements done, and at a similar speed and intensity of climbing. To a very large extent, elite-level swimmers principally swim for training. Champion cyclists ride, top runners run, and world-class skiers ski. A general sport like alpinism can include more non-specific modalities than these traditional sports, especially in the early base-building period and for less athletically mature individuals. But the biggest benefits will come from preparing for and modeling the demands of alpine climbing as closely as possible. This is the reason top climbers spend so much time climbing. As an alpinist seeking to improve your endurance, you should give priority to weight-bearing exercise. This means running or hiking, especially uphill, which will be more specific training than swimming. Cycling is also a great general exercise. However, bikes are very efficient modes of transportation, and this makes them less effective training tools from the time versus benefit standpoint. The sitting position on the bike means that you do not have to support your full body weight, which greatly reduces the energy cost of the exercise and the muscle mass used to propel yourself. Being strapped to a machine limits the range of motion, the coordination, balance, and variability of the footing required while climbing. You should not rely solely on cycling as a training mode. We have known some hardcore athletes who have gone so far as to remove the seat to avoid the temptation to sit down. Swimming is another great exercise that has little carryover to alpine climbing. The prone position in swimming makes it so the heart has to work much less to pump the blood. The water also keeps the body cool, leaving more blood available for the working muscles. If this is beginning to sound like running and hiking should be emphasized in your basic preparation time, then you are getting the picture. Preparation for success. While the authors are fully aware of the value of lessons learned in the school of hard knocks, we have written this book in an attempt to help you chart a more direct path to your own alpine success. We stated in Chapter 1 that you can't learn to lead thin ice or poorly protected pitches of rock from a book, but you can prepare for success in a rational way. This will not only give you a better shot at tagging that summit, but also allow you to minimize the risk while you do it. As we've discussed, athletes in mainstream sports train the component parts of their event many hundreds or thousands of times so that when their big day arrives, it is merely a matter of putting those well-practiced components together. This gives them the physical skills as well as the mental confidence necessary to succeed. Alpine climbers need to do the same thing. If the first time you lead a long runout pitch on loose rock is on your goal climb, you have not set yourself up for success. If carrying a heavy pack while dragging a sled to the 14,000-foot, 4,267-meter camp on the west buttress of Denali is the hardest day you've ever spent in the mountains, then you are very likely not going to have the physical and mental stamina to continue another 7 days to the summit. The individuality of training. The individual nature of each athlete's response to training has made many a coach's hair turn gray. We are not machines who all respond the same way to a given input. Training prescriptions are not cookbook recipes where mixing the same ingredients in the correct proportions will result in a perfect cake. Athletes are not cakes. Each of us has unique qualities we bring into this venture that results in our own unique response to it. To paraphrase Renato Canova, the one thing we can be certain of if we apply the same training to a group of athletes is that each individual will get a different response. The wisdom of this simple statement is lost on many coaches and athletes, but we will stress its importance. It is the basis for your critical analysis of every aspect of your training program. Since very few alpinists have the luxury of a personal coach, it will be very useful to know how best to regulate your own training to avoid the pitfalls that cause setbacks and lack of success in meeting performance goals. This individuality comes from numerous sources: genetic predisposition, training history and athletic background, time constraints, age, gender, life's daily stresses and how you deal with them, your current fitness and health. All of these elements have a significant effect on your response to training. The modern popularity of spreadsheet-type training plans, along with the internet gurus who espouse them, that list what workout you will be doing on a particular day 2 months from today, show a lack of understanding of this notion of individuality and of gauging the training to match the body's response. These spreadsheets have an emotional appeal. They look so planned and neat and tidy. How could they not be a roadmap to excellence? If your body was a simple machine like a car, that roadmap might prove useful. Understanding the language of intensity. The intensity of training determines the energy systems involved in producing the movements you are making. It also determines what types of muscle fibers, discussed in Chapter 3, get recruited to do the work. Therefore, it is important to understand and monitor the intensity of your training. At any given instant, your metabolism exists somewhere along an energy continuum. Higher intensity exercise requires a greater contribution of anaerobic energy supply than does lower intensity work. These anaerobic energy pathways cannot be sustained for as long as aerobic metabolism. We'll discuss this in detail in the next chapter. High intensities feel harder. Low intensities feel like you can go for a long, long time. Think of sprinting full out, high intensity, versus jogging slowly. By controlling the intensity of the training, you control both which types of muscle fibers get trained and which energy pathways are used. The endurance required for alpinism, with its long duration of low to moderate power outputs, is almost completely determined by the limitation of your aerobic metabolic processes. The implication of this important fact is that alpinists need to devote the vast majority of their training time to long duration, low to moderate intensity work that will enhance these aerobic qualities. Having a way to gauge intensity is a valuable training tool. Speed, power output, and perceived effort are all ways of gauging the intensity of your training. Perceived effort is highly subjective and, as such, an unreliable way to gauge training intensity, although it is the most commonly used one. Speed monitoring is handy if you are running around a track. Power metering devices are great gadgets for cyclists. Unfortunately, neither speed nor power measurements fit neatly into the constantly variable terrain and conditions of the alpinist, and perceived effort is not easily or accurately measured. Other methods have been developed that can prove useful for the training we propose. Later, we will explain some of the various methods for determining training intensity along with their relative merits. Each has its place and its adherence. In the end, they all are attempts to relate subtle, if not insensible, metabolic shifts to something you can perceive. Heart rate monitoring as an intensity guide. A simple way to gauge and quantify effort that does not put any burden on you to be observant is to use your heart rate. While not a 100% accurate reflection of intensity, heart rate measurement is very useful because of its portability. By using a wrist-mounted monitor, adaptability to a variety of terrain and modes of training, and ability to give instant feedback. These all make heart rate, HR, monitoring a valuable biofeedback tool. Even using the cheaper HR monitor will allow you to begin to recognize and relate to your body's subtle feedback system in a quantifiable way. You might surprise yourself when you begin to use an HR monitor and find out that what you had assumed was an easy effort is not so easy after all. Heart rate zones. Using percentages of maximum HR gives a reasonably good approximation of intensity for most athletes. This is the standard way of expressing intensity when other more accurate methods, such as a treadmill step test, which measures your blood lactate and oxygen uptake, are not available. The zones are defined as a percentage range of each individual's maximum heart rate and are described in detail in the next section. They range from zone 1 for the lowest intensity aerobic training through 5 for maximal effort. It is important to recognize that these zones are highly individual, depending mainly on your previous training background and genetics. If you have spent most of your training time at medium to high intensities, your zone 1 will be relatively low and small, while your zone 3 will cover a large range of HR. This is more indication of the individuality of training. Heart rate zones were originally described and utilized by Scandinavian cross-country ski racers in the early 1980s, when wrist-mounted HR monitors were first developed and manufactured by Polar Electro of Finland. These handy devices allowed the skiers to monitor their training intensity in a way that had never been available before. Other endurance athletes, such as runners and swimmers, had long been able to control the intensity of training based on their speed. Because every track and pool is a known distance, most variables that affect training could be controlled. The coach could assign training intensity based on the athlete's current level of fitness, assessed from recent race or time trial paces. Because of the cross-country ski racers' use of variable terrain without any uniformity of distance or conditions, the control enjoyed by runners and swimmers was not available to ski coaches. The nature of climbing in the mountains more closely mimics that of cross-country skiing, in terms of variability, than it does running on a track, making a heart rate monitor a useful training tool for alpinists. Since the 1980s, the zone system, sometimes in a slightly modified form, has gained nearly universal acceptance as providing good, basic training guidelines for endurance sports. While you can indeed rely on your perception of effort, as mentioned before, this has proven to be a very poor indicator for most people, and we do not recommend relying on it for controlling training intensity. We encourage you to use a HR monitor for at least some of your training. More or harder is not better. Use the full range of each given zone. Don't think that you must always be pushing the top end of each of these percentage ranges in order to get the benefits. For most of us, the typical prescribed 10% point range will translate into a maximum of 20 beats, and more likely in the 17 to 18 beat range. Allowing the intensity of your training to float around in each zone will hit all the physiological targets we are aiming for. Recovery zone, roughly 50% or less of max HR. Below zone 1 lies an intensity that plays a minor role in improving aerobic fitness. But this zone plays a major role in speeding recovery from the more demanding training sessions. You should feel better right after or within a few hours of completing one of these. It can be almost any form of light exercise, and you may benefit most from a modality different than your primary one. One of our favorites for hammered legs is going for a swim. For some, a 15-minute walk before bed will be perfect. Some will use daily foam rolls or yoga. Others may find a 1-hour slow jog does the trick. Heart rate for recovery workouts should be roughly 20% below the upper zone 1 heart rate. Wearing an HR monitor while climbing. If you routinely rock climb in a gym or at a crag, it can be interesting to wear an HR monitor while climbing. You will quickly identify what types of routes and what difficulty level elevates your heart rate to which zone. On routes near your limit, you will see your HR spike as you approach and execute the crux. You can also teach yourself how low you must bring your HR while resting at a good stance before launching into more difficult climbing. This is a valuable training modality if you incorporate technical rock climbing in your training plan.
Zone 1. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.